morning for the scripture reading. You ready, Luke? It's a marathon, not a sprint.
In the days when judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons. The name of the man was
Elimelech,
and the name of his wife was Naomi. And the names of his two sons were
Mahlon
and Chilion. They were.
This is so tricky. Ephrathites.
Ephrathites.
Yep.
From Bethlehem in Judah. They went to the country of Moab and remained there. But
Elimelech,
the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took
Moabite
wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. When they had lived there for about 10 years, both
Mahlon
and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left with her two sons or her husband. Then she started to return with her daughters-in-law from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had consideration for his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord will grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud. They said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people."
I don't know. You just keep going.
But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I'm too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear some
quarter of the book. The book of Judges, which is the one right before Ruth, ends in hopelessness. Left to our own devices, we tend to be horrible to each other and take each other's stuff. Ruth says, no, people are better than that. God doesn't need to break into our daily lives and tell us to be nice to each other. God doesn't need to offer a miracle to bribe us to be on our best behavior. Indeed, if we treat each other with love, we can catch glimpses of what God intends for this world. And in this last weekend, heading into the election, I am exhausted from all the political reporting, all the people saying horrible things about each other. Absolutely no one is saying of someone from the opposing camp, where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people and your God, my God. I know many of you are exhausted as well and perhaps came to church hoping that you could get a respite from all that noise. Now, there certainly are political issues in today's reading, like migration, and food insecurity, and the rights of women. So maybe some preachers are using those as a back door into the current situation. But I really believe that Jesus calls us to live in the real world and to come in by the front door. And all the saints whose names we read earlier in the service and lifted up in our hearts lived in the real world and struggled with it, so hiding from the struggle doesn't seem like a faithful response. Even though there is a huge part of me that is ready to head home and watch The Princess Bride on loop from now until Wednesday. No more rhyming and I mean it. Come on, there has to be some other fans in here.
Yeah, I love The Princess Bride too.
Anybody want a peanut? Right? Yeah. Right, that's what I'm saying. At the beginning of the Book of Ruth, Naomi is married with two sons. She's doubly connected with the power structure of her day through her husband and her sons. And then her husband dies while they are in Moab, escaping the famine around Bethlehem. Bethlehem means house of bread, so it has to be a pretty bad famine if you're going to leave Bethlehem. For 10 years, she's still okay. She still has her boys. They marry, and her household is now two sons and the two daughters-in-law. And then the sons die. And all of a sudden, she goes from as safe as is reasonable to expect in a world where a famine can drive you out of your homeland to completely vulnerable. Just take a beat and silently think about the folks around here who have gone from reasonably safe to completely vulnerable in less than 10 years. Naomi is a woman in her culture and of her culture. When she hears that the famine has receded in Israel, she heads back, planning to return to Bethlehem. Her daughters-in-law come with her, and since they are both widows and they have both married foreigners, at least in their world, right? They are completely vulnerable as well. Now, at some point on the road back to Bethlehem, Naomi stops. First, she offers her daughters-in-law a blessing. May the Lord deal kindly with you. May the Lord grant that you find security. It's interesting that she urges them to go back to their mother's house. They may not still have fathers living, or they may need the mother's influence to be back, accepted back into their father's house. And the word that is translated as security has this nuance of rest. And again, take a beat. Think about what it is like to go from vulnerability to being secure enough to rest. But Orpah and Ruth won't go. Naomi points out what staying with her means. Naomi is unlikely to find another husband, and even if she does, and even if she becomes the mother to more sons, what are Orpah and Ruth gonna do? Hang around and wait for the boys to grow up to marry women who are so much older than they are? No, right? She knows the real world. Naomi is never going to connect with the power structure of her culture again. She is always going to be on the edge. She is always going to be vulnerable. This is the hand she's been dealt by her culture, by God. And frankly, when you read her text, you know, there is a little bit of rage and fury coming off of Naomi. So again, take a beat and think about the folks in our culture who have gone from secure to vulnerable and who have that rage coming off them as well. Orpah goes back to her people and to her gods. That's all it says. She's not condemned. She did what was wise and sensible for anyone in her situation. We don't get to hear her end to the story. I think because we know the end of Ruth's story, we sometimes condemn Orpah, you know? But I think she made a reasonable decision. She too is a woman of her culture. Ruth is the one whose story we follow, and we see her all the way through to the end. Ruth may stay with Naomi, but she does not stay within the role assigned to women. She colors way outside the lines. She takes control of her life and the life that Naomi would be assigned, and she makes it abundant. One of her descendants is King David. And one of the descendants of King David is Jesus of Nazareth, born in that stable in Bethlehem, Ruth's new hometown. Now we can see Ruth as a superhero, slipping through and along the cracks of society, turning the norms into a tool that she uses to make life better for herself and for Ruth. She is an amazing woman who renews the life of all of Israel. As someone who came from outside the culture, a migrant, who didn't speak the language or worship the God of Israel, Ruth absolutely deserves her own book in the Bible. But there is no way, even on my best day, that I could do what she did. I can't even get through to the weather report on the 6 o'clock news because I can't stand the ads. But in her beautiful line that I long to hear in our political discourse, "Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God." She says, lodge. Where you lodge, I will lodge. And the root of that verb in Hebrew means to murmur or to complain. It's the same verb that comes up during the Exodus when the Israelites are heading for their new home, complaining the entire way. So this lodging Ruth is signing up for, it's not a place of security. It's not a place of rest. It is a place of discomfort and complaints and bitterness. And Ruth may be one of those who change the world, who challenge their culture and the roles they are assigned by it. Ruth may use the biases and assumptions her culture makes about how the vulnerable should live in order to for her to gain power and strength. She is awesome in so many ways. But she lives in the real world. She not only lodges in a place of discomfort and complaint, she chooses that place. Because given the way her world's configured at the moment, that is where the love is. where Naomi lives too. And Ruth is going to cling to the love in her life, even if that means lodging in discomfort. And on this day, when we are celebrating the saints in our lives, on this day, when we are saying our last prayers that the election goes smoothly, I think clinging to love and being willing to live in discomfort until the changes we want to see in our cultures have been accomplished is a pretty good message. Amen. So I just want to say the fire trucks have returned. And it's time to sing. Let's sing. Sing with all the saints in glory, which when you hear it, you will know the tune. Oh, that's very true. Okay. Excellent. It's the Ode to Joy. When you get a chance, give it a listen. It's very fun. Let me just really quickly take your pictures because I think it's weird today, and just make sure that I know who all is here. So let me ask the deacons, yes, I can use that in the plural, to gather up the offering, and then we will sing the doxology and our prayer of dedication. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let's join together in a prayer of dedication for the gifts we've been given. The words are in your bulletin. The earth belongs to you, O God, the world and all its blessing. For blessings of this life, and the gift of your salvation, we give you thanks and praise as you have sought us out to save us. Help us to seek your face among our neighbors, so that all may know the wonder of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Orpa into Oprah. And that is correct. She was going to be named after Orpa in the Bible, and there was a, they didn't spell it correctly on the birth certificate, so she became Oprah. So here's my question to you. What does it take to imagine people we dislike living in a place of discomfort and complaining? Like, can we make space in our heads that they may not be in a place of rest and security? Does it soften our attitude, or does it just let them get away with being more annoying?
Makes me feel guilty for thinking it in the first place.
Makes me feel guilty for thinking it in the first place. Oh, I am feeling that, my sister.
I actually had a experience with that a couple years ago. In my childhood, my grandmother was not a very kind woman to me, or my brother. And she wasn't kind to my mother either when she was a child. So there was a very unpleasant thought going through our heads for a while. But then a few years ago, my mother rang us, because she still talks to my grandmother as it's her choice, and she told me she had breast cancer and that she was going for an operation, for a mastectomy, a double mastectomy, and chemotherapy. And when I got the call, I was surprised to feel sad and guilty and scared for her.
Yeah.
And it was conflicting because this is the woman who had hurt me, had hurt my brother, had hurt my mother, and who scared for her because it was scary to go through.
Yeah.
I was feeling pain for her because it was painful, and I remember praying to God that night that He helped her see her through it. And she did, and she's fine, and she's cancer-free. And I'm sorry that I know she's doing well in Michigan, but it always stuck with me that after all that pain, after all that suffering, I still intrinsically found a way to forgive her.
So I was on Sunday mornings, even when you get to sleep in, which this makes this Sunday my favorite Sunday, I go to Dunkin' Donuts to get a fancy coffee on my way in. And I will tell you, the roads are not terribly full at 6:30, 6:15, 6 o'clock on a Sunday morning, even if you did get to sleep. So I put on my blinker and I go to get off the highway to go to my easiest access, easy on, easy off, Dunkin' Donuts. And a car comes in from the middle lane, gets right in front of me, and I'm like, dude, I'm getting off. Just take a deep breath and you can have the whole lane. And they proceed to get off. And I'm just... So the blue cloud of curses that followed that car off to wherever it was going. And then I get to Dunkin' Donuts and there's a line, which they're usually, I'm like waking up the staff there. And I just thought, you know, you're gonna ask this question about making space in your heart and in your mind for these people that are living a tough life, and yet the minute someone cuts you off in traffic, you are just nowhere near that. And if that's my instinct, how do I retrain my instinct to not go there? And yet, how do I train my instinct to not go there and still not be just a doormat for every rude, horrible person in this world? I don't have an answer. I just was thinking, like, how insanely ironic is it that you have written the question down and you can't even come up with an answer for it? It was hard. It was hard. And I hope they got to wherever they were going safely. I think we're having coffee hour. Yes? If nothing else, we have approximately 2 metric tons of Halloween candy.
Take it home.
Yes. So next Saturday we are having a funeral here for Alan Fessenden. We could use some help making sure that people are welcomed and that, you know, it's not always obvious for people when they come to this church that you need to go upstairs. So if we could get some help, that would be awesome. I know Sue is working on the, we might need fewer people if the elevator isn't elevating, because that's one of the stations we need people for. So, but we're working on it. If you would be willing to help, it's at 11 o'clock on Saturday morning. If you could speak with Russell, that would be great. We will celebrate communion next Sunday on the other side of the election, to remind ourselves that Jesus calls all of us to sit at one table. That's what the sign out front is reminding us of. Next Sunday, the book group will meet at 4:30 at Anna John's house. The address is in the bulletin. I'm wondering if there's anyone who would be interested in ringing the bell on Veterans Day on 11/11 at 11:11 a.m. To remember Veterans Day. Russell will do that. Thank you, Russell. I appreciate that. The following Sunday, on the 17th, I will be away, but Judy Copeland will be here, and she is an amazing human. We will also be having faith formation that morning, focusing on giving thanks. I mean, there's a shocker that that's what we're doing in November. But both the kids' session and the adult activities look pretty awesome. So I would recommend, if you're interested, to come by. Our stewardship season ends next Sunday. So please, please, please turn in your pledge forms. There are blank forms at the end of your bulletin. If somehow you've managed to not have a pledge form enter your life, we can so fix that. We can so fix that. The take-home meal classics, I think, is what we're calling them now. We're not calling them the ones that have been in the freezers for a while. The take-home meal classics are on sale for $5. The Christmas raffle baskets, both mocktails, the alcohol-free version, and in the spirit, the alcohol version, are looking for some more donations. Are there other announcements?
Just an FYI, I'm well aware that the phone in the kitchen is not working. The device itself is fine after we tested it. It's the line, and Peter and I are working at getting that traced and figure out why that particular line is not working.
Okie doke. All right, then let us gather together in the prayer to send us back out into the world. It's in your bulletin. Loving God, stay with us where we stay. Go with us where we go.
Keep us safe and full of love and community, walking into a new world we are creating and waiting our whole lives to know more of you.
May we, your eager and sometimes awkward saints, carry in us a common hope with which all can share.
Comfort for loss, courage for speaking, compassion for healing.
In this coming week, help us not only to remember but to act in your truth that where you go, we will go.
That where you lodge, you will lodge. The neighbor you will shall be our people.
And you are the God of us all.
May nothing separate us from you and from the saints who have gone before us.
We give you thanks for both the shelter and the road. Amen and
amen.
All right. So, let me invite all who are interested to form a circle, holding hands down the center aisle. If you would prefer not to, just stay in your seat. I'll offer the blessing, and we'll say God be with you. And we won't play the toast food, but I gotta tell you, you are missing something fantastic. It is, for all the saints, one more time, but it is to the Beatles. The Beatles tune. It is fantastic. Both Candy and I were like, how does Ethan do it? May the Lord continue to watch over us, keeping us close to him and in a just path. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.